Can you survive being torn apart atom by atom? How fast do you have to go before you turn into a lizard? And what's the real deal with time travel anyway? Keep watching to find out. The 1966 pilot episode of Star Trek, titled Where No Man Has Gone Before, wasn't actually the first episode filmed for the series. 2 years before, another pilot called The Cage was filmed, sporting a number of differences, including an entirely different captain. Instead of James T. Kirk, it was Christopher Pike manning the captain's chair, the same Pike who would later lead Star Trek Strange New Worlds. The studio didn't like the first pilot and commissioned a second with a number of changes, including a new captain and first officer. After the second pilot debuted, the studio didn't want to waste the footage from The Cage, so it was cut up and used as flashbacks in the two-part episode The Menagerie. In the years prior to home video, this led many to believe they had actually watched The Cage on television in the 1960s. Decades later, in celebration of the franchise's 20th anniversary in 1986, The Cage was released on VHS and Laserdisc, reassembled using a mix of scenes from The Menagerie and a black-and-white print owned by Gene Roddenberry. Just a year later, a film archivist found the original 35mm color negatives, and in 1988, as a part of a primetime special, The Cage finally aired on TV. Vulcans are seemingly emotionless beings, guided by a strict sense of logic. But that's not quite true. They have all the same emotions as any human. They've just chosen to suppress them. We've seen emotional Vulcans a number of times in Star Trek, usually when their logic fails them due to an outside influence, illness, when they reject traditional Vulcan teachings, or during the debilitating 7-year mating cycle known as Ponfar.
I suppose most of us overlook the fact that even Vulcans aren't indestructible.
In the original Star Trek episode This Side of Paradise, Spock inhales the spores of an alien flower and is overcome with strong feelings of love. In the Next Generation episode Sarek, the Vulcan illness called Bendai's syndrome causes a breakdown of Sarek's emotional control. In the Voyager episode Blood Fever, the Vulcan Ensign Vorik becomes rageful during his Ponfar when unable to take a Vulcan mate. Star Trek Enterprise, meanwhile, suggested that living among humans can cause a Vulcan to be more emotional because humans are a reminder of the way Vulcans used to be.
Listen to me, you're making a mistake!
When your logic doesn't work, you raise your voice. You've been on Earth too long.
The fifth Star Trek movie, The Final Frontier, focused on Spock's half-brother, Sybok, and his rejection of Vulcan tradition. Before the time of the Vulcan messiah, Surak, founder of Vulcan logic, Vulcans were a warlike people fueled by emotions. But thanks to the teachings of Surak, Vulcans are now trained to repress feelings through strict mental discipline, and sometimes undergo a ritual called the Kolinar, which purges the last remnants of emotions. That said, there are plenty of examples of Vulcans who rebel against their culture's tradition. Airing for 2 seasons, Star Trek The Animated Series continued the adventures of the Starship Enterprise after the original show's cancellation, with nearly the entire cast of the original series reprising their roles. Thanks to animation, the stories were able to envision truly wild aliens, environments, and situations, some of which were pretty weird, including an episode with a gigantic 20-foot-tall clone of Spock, and a race of beings who could separate their head and legs. The show is largely seen today as a curious oddity, and given its sometimes off-the-wall stories, it's not usually clear if it's meant to be considered canonical. The answer is a little complicated. Most of Star Trek never directly acknowledged anything that happened in the series, but there are lots of small details that first appeared in the animated series that have shown up in live-action Trek. Spock's home city of Shikar is first mentioned in the animated series, and referenced in Deep Space Nine and even visited in Enterprise. The animated cat-like Kazinti race is mentioned in Picard, and the Klingon ship the Klothos gets a mention in Deep Space Nine as well. These are just a few of the small Easter eggs scattered throughout Trek canon. So, is it part of the main Trek storyline? Was there ever a 2-story-tall Spock clone running around? The short answer is probably. While many of the details mentioned in the animated series don't line up with timelines later established in Trek proper, modern writers have used the cartoon as a source of inspiration and cherry-picked key elements for more canonical stories. Star Trek fans who only started watching with the arrival of the movies might be surprised to learn that the Klingons in the original series were just human-looking beings with goatees and gold tunics. But when the franchise transitioned to the big screen, the Klingons got a major facelift. With a big screen budget, producers wanted a more alien-looking race, and so the Klingons suddenly had big forehead ridges, sharp teeth, and a new unusual language. This is how the Klingons would mostly remain. Later, Star Trek The Next Generation established them as an honor-bound and ritualistically warlike people who glorified combat as a cultural tradition. But their visual changes weren't yet explained. In fact, when three Klingons from the original show appeared on Deep Space Nine, they sported ridged foreheads, reinforcing the notion that Klingons had simply always looked this way. But that would start to change in the DS9 episode Trials and Tribulations, when it was acknowledged for the first time.
What happened? Some kind of genetic engineering?
A viral mutation?
We do not discuss it with outsiders.
An episode of Enterprise several years later explained the changes canonically as the result of a genetic plague. While a clever idea and a solid story, it created the expectation among fans that changes to designs should have an in-story explanation, causing serious discussion when Star Trek Discovery once again updated the look of the Klingons. The Vulcan salute seen in Star Trek has become an indelible part of pop culture, but what does it really mean and where did it come from? The first question is pretty simple, as the salute is a visual gesture representing the oft-spoken Vulcan greeting.
Live long and prosper, Spock.
Generally, Vulcans in Star Trek use the salute as both a greeting and a goodbye, meaning it's essentially the science fiction aloha. We have actor Leonard Nimoy to thank for its origins, having come up with the salute for the episode Amok Time, when Spock returns to Vulcan. Nimoy told StarTrek.com, "The idea came when I saw the way director Joe Pevney was staging the scene. He had me approach T'Pau, and I felt a greeting gesture was called for, so I suggested it to Joe, who accepted it immediately." Nimoy has gone on to explain that he was inspired by Jewish religious leaders from his youth who used the same gesture during certain ritual prayers, saying, "When I saw the split-fingered gesture of these men, I was entranced. I learned to do it simply because it seemed so magical." James T. Kirk was the first captain of the 1701 Enterprise, right? Well, no. We already learned that Captain Christopher Pike was the original captain in the cage, but you'd be wrong again. Introduced in Star Trek The Animated Series episode, The Counterclock Incident, Captain Robert April is actually the first person to helm the classic Enterprise NCC-1701. As mentioned earlier, the animated series isn't 100% officially canon, but this is one bit of background information from that series that writers of Discovery drew from. Not only did he get a name drop in the first season as one of Starfleet's most decorated officers, but Pike's own service record on screen shows that he took command of the Enterprise from its previous captain, Robert April. April himself makes an appearance in Strange New Worlds, finally in his true canonical form. How does time travel work in the Trek universe? The short answer is however the writers want it to. You'll probably never find a consistent answer across different episodes and movies. Two episodes of the original series and the film The Voyage Home had the Enterprise use the slingshot maneuver to create a time warp by manipulating the gravity of a star, while at least two episodes have used the Guardian of Forever, a sentient portal, to move back and forth through time. But the question remains, how do the rules of time travel work in Star Trek? In most episodes, the franchise has used Back to the Future rules, where changing history results in an altered present. This kind of time travel was most notably used in City on the Edge of Forever, in which the time-stranded members of the Enterprise couldn't prevent the death of Edith Keeler without destroying their own future hundreds of years later. The movie First Contact and the Deep Space Nine episode Past Tense also played by the same rules. Some stories, however, have used causality loop rules, where we discover that the travel back in time was part of history all along, and they just didn't know it. This is how the Next Generation two-parter Time's Arrow worked, with the crew discovering Data's head on Earth, buried for hundreds of years even before they traveled back in time. But more recently, a third time travel rule set appeared in the 2009 Star Trek movie from J.J. Abrams, in which the Romulan Nero's travel back in time resulted in the creation of an entirely new branching reality. Ultimately, the writers of Star Trek seem to use whatever rules they want to serve the story in front of them, and space is weird, so that's okay. The 1967 Star Trek episode The Squire of Gothos features an enigmatic villain named Trelane, a powerful trickster who kidnaps Kirk and Sulu off the bridge of the Enterprise. After they're rescued, Trelane appears on the bridge of the ship without explanation, and with no discernible technology, transports the entire bridge crew down to his planet. He magically changes people's clothing, plays childish games with the crew, and speaks to them in French.
Ah, monsieur, vive la gloire, vive Napoleon!
Later, they're put on trial, where Trelane is the judge in full courtroom dress. Eventually, his games are put to an end not by Kirk, but by a pair of non-corporeal beings who scold Trelane for misbehaving, revealing him to be little more than a child of his godlike race. If this sounds familiar, it's because this all bears a striking resemblance to the character of Q, who tormented the Enterprise-D in Next Generation in a very similar way. Q also kidnaps crew members, pops onto the bridge of the Enterprise, causes impromptu costume changes, and has more than once dressed as a judge and put the crew of the Enterprise on trial. He's also fond of speaking French.
Au contraire, mon capitaine! He's back!
But Star Trek has dozens of all-powerful beings, so the question of whether Trelane is himself a Q has been the subject of debate. According to actor John Delancey, who played Q, the answer is a clear and unequivocal yes, according to a 2010 interview with StarTrek.com. And even though it's non-canon, the novel Q Squared by Peter David confirmed that Trelane was a renegade who hailed from the race known as the Q Continuum, though nothing on screen has yet confirmed it. The holodeck has provided Star Trek opportunities to venture to new worlds within the confines of the ship, able to recreate everything from a Romulan landscape to a jazz club. The room uses a combination of hard light holograms, force fields, and replicator technology, which together can create the illusion of an endless, fully interactive 3D environment. And thanks to replicators, a person in the holodeck can even leave the confines of the room and take a simulated object with them. We've also seen the capabilities of the holodeck expanded on a few occasions. Voyager kicks holograms up a notch by inventing holographic technology that allows their doctor to roam the ship freely. In a later Voyager episode, Dark Frontier, the crew tied two holodecks together, allowing one team to operate on a recreation of Voyager, while the other simulates a mission on a Borg cube, with actions in one affecting the other. Likewise, in The Killing Game, an alien race called the Hirogen take over Voyager and install holo emitters throughout the ship, turning the multiple decks into one massive simulation of 1940s wartime France. The holodecks have been shown to be a huge drain on the ship's power, and are usually the first things shut down in emergencies. They are also extremely vulnerable to malfunctions, with power surges switching off safety protocols or making exit impossible. This has made the holodecks the source of much drama, since the crew can get trapped in a dangerous world within their own ship, and intelligent holograms might just try to take over the Enterprise once in a while. One of the most fundamental pieces of technology on Star Trek, the transporter, is also one of the most baffling. Since it converts a person into energy and then reforms them at another location, many have wondered if a transporter actually kills you and creates a duplicate of you on the other end. It's probably the best scientific and philosophical question the series has raised, but it's rarely addressed on screen.
If you got some reason you want my atoms scattered all over space, boy.
According to the science of the show, the transporter works by scanning and converting your physical matter into a stream of all your subatomic particles. Once a location is selected for transport, your matter stream is beamed there and reassembled. The same particles that were you before are still you after. But the problems arise when it's not the same particles, such as when a duplicate of Will Riker was created by a second transporter beam in the episode Second Chances. If the original matter that was Riker rematerialized on the ship, where did the matter that made the second Riker come from? A lot can go wrong, and it often does. Because the transporter doesn't have to reconstitute you using the same atoms, it can replace them with new ones using the blueprint the transporter created of your energy pattern. This is why some believe a transporter is a kill and copy machine. We're left to take the word of fictional Star Trek scientists. The transporter doesn't kill you, it transports the real you, body, soul, and all. Introduced in the first episode of Enterprise, the character referred to by fans as Future Guy was a projection that spoke to people in the 22nd century from a far-off future. Through his vague silhouette, he would speak to the villainous Suliban to influence events in his past for his own ends. Another time traveler named Daniels traveled back to recruit Archer to help stop him and put an end to what he called the Temporal Cold War. But who was this Future Guy? Unfortunately, the series abandoned the plot thread before viewers would get concrete answers. Speaking at a convention in 2009, series producer Brennan Braga and former showrunner Manny Coto claimed that a proposed fifth season would have revealed Future Guy as a Romulan attempting to change history. But on Twitter in 2015, Braga stated that the original plan was that the mystery villain would have been revealed as Captain Archer himself, attempting to manipulate his destiny from the future. In the expanded universe of Star Trek novels, the shadowy baddie was revealed to be Jamrin Harnath, a 28th century time agent who worked for an organization called the Order of the Omega. On screen, there's yet to be a definitive answer. Whether or not going faster than Warp 10 is possible is a question that's plagued Trek for decades, because the series seems to have rewritten the rules of warp travel more than once. In the original Trek series episode Journey to Babel, it's said that speeds above warp 10 are unsafe, while in The Changeling, anything above warp 15 is called a multi-warp. Meanwhile, in an animated series episode, the Enterprise went as fast as warp 36. By the time of The Next Generation, it seems that the fastest possible speed a starship could achieve was warp 9.9. According to the Star Trek Voyager episode Threshold, anything warp 10 or beyond was infinite velocity and meant you would exist at every point in the universe simultaneously. Time and distance would have no meaning. But in achieving warp 10, Tom Paris and Captain Janeway wound up evolving into slug-like creatures. So while it seems that achieving such speeds are technically possible, they're not really recommended. Still, there are other ways of traveling the stars that are faster than warp 9.9. We've seen a slipstream drive in use on Voyager and a protostar drive on Star Trek Prodigy, both moving ships beyond the highest warp speeds. And the spore drive on Discovery cuts speed out of the equation entirely, just putting you wherever you need to be using the power of space mushrooms. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Looper videos about your favorite sci-fi franchises are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.